are turning uglier in Virginia as the drumbeats get louder for calls for Governor Ralph Northam to resign over his blackface yearbook photo scandal. And now, Lieutenant Governor Justin Fairfax, who would take Northam's place, is facing his own scandal, facing sexual assault allegations. Let's go to our A-team. Hugo Gurdon, editorial director for the Washington Examiner. Leslie Marshall, Fox News contributor, Democratic strategist and progressive radio host. And Matt Gorman, former communications director for the National Republican Congressional Committee. And Matt, welcome to America's Newsroom.
Thank you very
A-team,
much.
Nice to have you this morning.
Thank you.
Start off with you first. What do you think happens here?
Went from bad to worse, didn't it, for Virginia Democrats? Look, I think Ralph Northam has absolutely nothing to lose right now. Maybe he was behind it, maybe he wasn't. But three things I know for certain. Ralph Northam not going anywhere. Justin Fairfax is certainly a diminished political figure in these last 72 hours than he was before. And there's state legislative elections in Virginia this November. I think this is going to really affect them. And look, I think Justin Fairfax has a very interesting story, and he needs to get his inconsistencies kind of straightened out. Went from nothing happened to something happened, but it was consensual. We're not sure where things lie. He has some answers.
Okay, here's Justin Fairfax in his own words on the allegations he
faces. So it is all completely political. It's a complete smear. The manipulation is completely obvious. I mean, this is one of the most blatant examples of a smear that I think you could see was something that's completely uncorroborated. And as I said before, the reason it's uncorroborated is because it's not true. It won't be corroborated because it's not true and it didn't happen in the way that was portrayed.
How they work this out?
Well,
what is the way out?
You have to look at the timing of this. I mean, somebody did this. Whether it came from Northam, who I think the folks in his camp, quite frankly, had way too much on their plate with the blackface and the KKK hood and dealing with that. So I'm really not sure that it came from there. But there are others who want Democrats out on the right. I mean, there are those on the right that have already denied that they had anything to do with it, the mayor, for example. But I do think that the timing is questionable because it would seem, look at the timing. On the eve of when he might have been ascending, if you will, to the throne of the governorship. He's also an African-American in light of what happened with Northam. And I was one of the first Democrats, by the way, who asked him to step down and resign right here on this network. I do think there's something.
So to be clear, are you questioning the sexual assault allegation against Fairfax?
I'm questioning the timing of it, yes.
Interesting. That would be interesting to hear from you.
Yes.
Yeah, I think one has to be very suspicious of the governor. He's a doctor and he's shown just in the last few days that he has a very gentle bedside manner, but he can say some pretty extraordinary things. And that was, for example, on the abortion law. He accused Ed Gillespie of really viciously of racism in the last election. He's shown that he can really play low politics. The fact of the timing, as Leslie was saying, is deeply suspicious, I think.
Absolutely. I think, he has some questions to answer, though. There's serious inconsistencies, and as Britt mentioned, with Brett Kavanaugh, the media, Democrats didn't give him the benefit of the doubt. They're giving Fairfax, or at least the chance to explain this away. I think Fairfax's accuser just hired Christine Blasey Ford's law firm, so we're going to see where this plays out.
Do you think ultimately Northam steps down?
Yeah, I think he has to step down. I think this is much too damaging for him. And the fact is that the Democratic Party has not been willing to take no prisoners on racial issues hitherto. They're not going to let him get away.
Okay, topic number two now. Covington Catholic is firing back, at least the kid who was accused, Nick Salmon. He's hired a well-known attorney by the name of Lynn Wood. Lynn Wood also represented it was Richard Jewell and the 1996 Atlanta Olympic bombing. They put together a 15-minute clip that involves a lot of the material that happened prior to the Native American drum, et cetera, which ran on for about an hour, I do believe. So the clip is out. They've got words in the bottom of the screen. This is part of how they're making their public case now.
This is a bunch of future school shooters.
You get old enough, they're gonna steal your organs.
Why are you being mean?
Mr. Phillips began moving to his right, down a line of boys, eventually stopping face to face with Nick Sandman. The young man remained where he had already been standing, placing his undivided attention on Mr. Phillips, who never once tried to move beyond him.
it goes on from there, and they have filed suit now or put a number of defendants on notice. I think 51 total list right now. News organizations, individual news personalities, CNN, NBC, MSNBC, Washington Post, CBS, Elizabeth Warren, Ilhan Omar, the newly elected member of Congress from Michigan, Kathy Griffin, Jim Carrey. It's a long, long list. Leslie, you wrote a piece at foxnews.com after this story first erupted and then started to die down a little bit. And you wrote this, you said, Covington students are still kids. Why did so many adults ignore that in the rush to condemn them? End quote.
Yes. But whether it's a lawsuit for libel that's going to be victorious, I wouldn't say, and I'll tell you why. Opinion is correct, is protected by free speech, by the First Amendment. Secondly, if you put out there misinformation and then you come back and you correct that information, there's no longer libel, there's no longer slander. And in addition, what was the damage done by the defamation to the individual? So legally, those are the boxes that would have to be checked 100% in order for these 51 cases to be ruled in the Covington student's favor.
You Google his name, that high school student's name, and the reaction that he received lives on.
There's no question his reputation is stained. And while Leslie's right, there might not be legal remedies, I think he has every right to fight back. I think many Democrats and some in the media used this young man as a vessel for their hatred, whether it's President Trump or Republicans. I think he has every right to restore his reputation. I'm not a lawyer, but I think it's positive that they're taking some proactive steps to do just that.
Lynn Wood, I mentioned the attorney. Part of his statement reads the following. As we analyze the mountain of false publications of action and statements about Nick, we'll be looking at causes of action behind defamation and intentional infliction of emotional distress, including actions based on cyberbullying and assault.
Yeah. You know, I think that the point about whether this is all actionable is a good one. There's a defense in defamation that's against something called mere vulgar abuse. And a lot of what this boy, whose reputation clearly has been stained, was subjected to was vulgar abuse by Hollywood people, by some journalists, etc. The actionable stuff would be against those news organizations, perhaps like the Washington Post, who just put out what is now been proven to be an absolutely false story based on Nathan Phillips' a dishonest account.
All right, final thoughts real quick before the big night. Your expectations for the president's State of the Union address. We'll start with you, Matt.
One thing I'm watching, I think more than infrastructure or immigration, is drug pricing. I think President Trump has an incentive to pass something big through divided government. President Trump and Democrats are much closer on drug pricing than I think many people think, as we saw in 2016 with a lot of his rhetoric on the stump.
I am hearing that he wants to talk about greatness. He wants to talk about unity and bipartisanship. Infrastructure is a great way to do that. Curious what he'll say about immigration, if there's going to be any announcement of a national security issue. Quite, I think he should stay away from any talk about the governor of Virginia and anything there regarding late-term abortion or blackface or KKK hoods.
I think he's going to have a very tough time doing different things. One is emphasizing unity and other is on national security, which is bound to bring up the wall and immigration. That's the biggest dividing policy that he has. So I think he's going to have it difficult to square those two things.
Set it up nicely. Our A-team, thank you.
Thank you. Nice to have you. Thanks, Leslie. Thanks, Matt. Thank you.